Scientists have made a new discovery about the human brain. It is more like a living word cloud that responds to the meaning of words in more ways than ever thought before. WSJ science reporter Lee Hotz joins us now with the details. Hi, Lee. This is very interesting. So scientists measured the effects words have on our brains. Is that right?
Yes. One of the miracles of the mind is that the words that you and I speak out loud, you know, span that gulf between us, and they evoke the same meanings in my brain and the same meanings in your brain. I mean, how do we possibly do that? It's an extraordinary trick. And hundreds of studies have gone into trying to figure this out. Most recently, today, a group at the University of California at Berkeley has announced that for the first time, they've constructed a comprehensive map, not of words, but of the meanings in your brain that words evoke when we speak them. Now, they did a very clever thing to tease this out. They had volunteers and a brain scanner, a functional magnetic resonance imager, and they had those people listen to autobiographical stories, to narratives, actually that had been recorded by people performing on the Moth Radio Hour, which appears on many public radio stations, where, you know, people stand up in an open mic and they tell very moving stories about themselves. In this case, the stories range from a fellow who talked about recovering his repressed childhood memories, a woman who told of her dealing with her self-esteem issues by becoming an exotic dancer. 10 to 15 minute narratives while their brains were being scanned, a total in these stories of 10,000 words. And they very cleverly organized these words into concepts, and they were able, by tracking the blood flow in the brain as your neurons started to pop in response here and pop in response there, and they made this map. And what it tells us are two very interesting things. One is that previous to this, we kind of thought language was just concentrated in one part of the brain, in the left hemisphere. What this shows is that actually meaning, there's a broad landscape that encompasses like the entire cerebral cortex. That's 20 billion neurons. And most tellingly, you and I share this pattern. So
interesting. So did this study also track the emotional responses to these words?
It did not. And I should be very clear about this. It didn't look at the sort of the words themselves. I mean, in terms of phonetics or sound or emotional valence. It's a very good point. No, they tried to isolate the meaning of the word. And partly it was an artifact of how fast the machines can detect what happens in your brain.
Absolutely.
Meaning is a little slower than our ability to sort of work our way through the actual phonetics of speech.
Absolutely. So did it track the meaning, the response to individual words or to the compilation of these words in so much as they became a story?
A compilation of words, but not as they became a story, but as they kind of clustered in context.
I see.
They gathered these words of the 10,000 common English words, and it's important to note that these were people who were native English speakers. It's not clear that whether this would work the same in Japanese or Hindi or Urdu, although they suspect it probably is universal. They then collected these into 200 sort of clusters of concepts, things like touch or color or family or violence, and that's what they mapped. And it's a very intriguing thing they did because it does get at this universality of our ability to share our knowledge and
through
our experiences.
Language. Through language.
Through language.
Yes.
Now, they do acknowledge that it may be this common pattern that you and I share. Mm-hmm. We have this because we acquired it as a consequence of shared cultural experience. And it may not hold up. There's a lot of work yet to be done.
Fascinating stuff. Lee, thank you so much for telling us about it.
Always a pleasure.